off the side, okay? Way it's gonna be set up is the first 30 minutes, they're gonna go 15 minutes each. Dennis is gonna start, no, Bernie's gonna start, Dennis will finish. And then we'll do, they'll have questions, rebuttals, it'll be like 3 minutes. I'll ask a couple questions, and as soon as you guys wanna start asking questions, the better. I would prefer that it went just you guys asking questions, because that's what this will bring a lot of stuff out. And that's really what we're trying to accomplish here. So that's basically it. Make sure the phones are off, and let's go.
Okay. Well, thank you guys all for coming here. I wanted you to know that meetup.com is a website where I'm organized these meetings called West Side Science and Religion Discussion Group, and also the Vancouver Science and Religion Discussion Group. So if you want to find out about events like this in the future, I encourage you to go there. Just go to meetup.com. You can search for atheist or Christian or science, and you'll find us that way. Okay. First thing I want to mention is my t-shirt. I wanted to wear this for an effect. You know, a lot of Christians, especially if you're an evangelical Christian, you really believe the Bible, you believe Jesus is going to come any minute. And he can come any time. But if you don't believe in God, you think this world can actually stay around for quite a while if we take care of it. And it's not a stretch to say it could be here for millions of years if we take care of it. If you look at how technology has increased in the last 50 years, it's amazing. So just imagine the year, just think 1,000 years from now, 2,000 years. Personally, I believe that we're going to have a new thing called machine life come out. So just like now they say, well, how did life come from non-life? A couple thousand years from now, people are going to be thinking, you know, how did this happen? We got machine life now, too, you know. So it's going to be I think it's just kind of an interesting thing. I also wanted to mention that there's a lot of different kind of atheists, and I'm not going to speak for every atheist. I'm just giving my opinion. So if you're an atheist, feel free to just say, we'll have a Q&A time. You can give your viewpoint also. So I see, what is the evidence for God? I see there's four categories, generally speaking, and this is what you have in your overview here. And if I have extra time, I've got a whole bunch of other material to go over, so I'm just going to see how far I get in 15 minutes. So to begin with, I think a lot of the evidence boils down to God of the gaps. And what is that? Basically, it's an argument from ignorance. It says, you know what, how did the Big Bang happen? We have no idea how that could happen. Therefore, God did it. Or how did life come from non-life? We have no idea. Obviously, God did it. So basically, this whole thing about God of the gaps, it was... The person credited with that as evangelist, his name was Henry Drummond in 1890. It was shortly after Darwin in 1880. And he basically came up with this idea. Now remember, he's an evangelist, he's a theologian. He says this is a bad thing to do, because the problem is, you say there's these things in science we don't know, and we'll say God did that, and then science discovers some things, and your God shrinks. And he says you don't want to have a shrinking God. You want to have a God that's better and more healthy as a theologian to say, our God's sustainer. He made these natural processes. You know, so give God credit for all these things that are going on in the world. Don't just say he's working these things where we don't understand. So anyway, as we listen to arguments from Dennis, think about it. Is the argument really boiled down to, this is so amazing, we don't know how it could happen, therefore God did it? Think about that. Because I think that's a huge part of it. And sometimes it's very complicated. Look at these micro machines in biology. It's so complicated. It's just mind-blowing. Therefore, God did it. It's just, we don't know. Therefore, God did it. It's very important to understand that. Another area, I think, that for evidence in God is in personal feelings. You know, I feel a relationship with Jesus. I know Jesus is true. I know God is true. I was an evangelical Christian for 25 years. I know what these feelings are. I've had these feelings. I used to also debate with Mormons, and they said to pray about the Book of Mormon, and God will give you a sign, a feeling of burning the bosom if it's true. I did. I prayed that. And one time I actually got that feeling. Here's the conversation I had. So I basically prayed to God, you know, is this book true? You know, and I got this feeling in my heart, yeah, it's true. And my mind said, okay, Bernie, I guess you're a Mormon now. And my next thought was, wait a minute, how can you be a Mormon with what you know? Because my mind, I studied Mormonism. I know that it doesn't work out. So then I said, yeah, I guess you're right, you know, I can't be a Mormon. So my mind saved me basically from following my heart. And that conversation I had with myself was about, you know, 5 or 10 seconds. So I said I was a Mormon for 10 seconds.
Thank God you're
a Mormon. Because I'm the US, I guess. And then, you know, there's animists. They think there's spirits and all kinds of things. There's spirits in the trees and the rocks and the wind. And of course, an evangelical Christian said it's nonsense. But of course, there's not spirits in the trees and the rocks. But these people think there are, and they have a relationship with these rocks. You know, it's like, don't hurt your, you know, if you don't have to, and things like that. And then, you know, kids have a relationship with Santa, too. And, you know, it's so real to them, they'll write my message, you know. So my point here is, do not use personal feelings to determine truth. That's really going to mess you up. Basically, I think the personal feelings follow from your subconscious, and your subconscious basically is working on a lot of facts in the background. So if you have a bad understanding, you're going to get these feelings that aren't really true. So it's very dangerous. Another category that people might use for evidence for God is the Bible. William Lane Craig did this in an argument, in a debate lately with Dr. Krauss, who is a physicist. And he basically said, Jesus, the Bible talks about Jesus rising from the dead, and, you know, that's very possible, and it's very probable with all this, you know, with all the stories. How else can you explain it? And since this is so probable, that's proof for God. And so I just want to bring up some problems with the Bible. One is in 1 Corinthians 15:4-6, Paul said, there's over 500 people that saw Christ was risen. And then some evangelists might say, see, you know, you put that in there, you can even check that yourself if you're alive at that time. But you can't really check it if you're alive at that time, because you didn't say, who are these people? Where were they at? When did it happen? There's no evidence at all to even check it up. It's just a claim. Hey, 500 people saw this, you know. I could say there was a UFO in my backyard. 1,000 people saw it, you know. I didn't give names or anything. So another one is Jesus had bad behavior. In, especially if you read Matthew 21:18-21, you see him cursing a fig tree and killing it. Why? Because it didn't have figs. Why was that so bad? Because he was hungry. He wanted figs. And it wasn't even the season for figs, but he cursed it and killed that tree. That's not, there's nothing noble in that. And there's no way to, and then the evangelist might say, well, that's because it was a sign about judging Israel. Well, if you look at it in context, it has nothing to do with that, especially in the Matthew version. The other version, there's another version where it's he curses it, and then they go to Jerusalem, and they come back, and they find out it's dead. But in Matthew, it's cursed and dead. Boom. The other one, Jesus gives wrong advice. He says, turn the other cheek to somebody who wants to be mean to you. That's wrong. That's wrong. He's supposed to be God. He's giving wrong advice. Okay? If somebody wants to hurt you, this is what I tell my kids. And I had a hard time with this when I was a Christian, but now I know it's a smarter thing to do. If somebody's trying to hurt you or whatever, you can run away. You can warn them. And at the very least, you can defend yourself. But the last thing you want to do is be a victim and say, you know, boom, hit me on the cheek. Okay, hit me on the other one too. It's right here. That's the last thing you want to do. And this is what Jesus is saying to do. So, you know, it'll really mess you up. It messed me up as a parent. Jesus did have some good advice, though. I mean, like, do unto others as you want them to do unto you. Confucius said that 500 years earlier. So, you know, there is some good stuff in the Bible that got in there. Copies from other people, supposedly, maybe. Socrates and Plato are still quoted a lot in philosophy. They're 400 years before Christ. To put that in perspective, 400 years, you know, America's only 200 years old. So think about that, twice as long as America's been in existence, in the ancient ages even. I mean, nowadays we have internet, we can capture this knowledge and stuff, but this is two lifespans of the USA before Jesus, and you know, all this philosophy that was known, and people still live by some of this philosophy. It's pretty amazing. Jesus had a major false prophecy. You know, some atheists make fun of this. They put up a bulletin board that says, you know, 2,000 years of any time now, you know, Jesus said he's going to come back. And, of course, we saw this just lately with Harold Camping's recent false prophecy that, you know, the end of the world was last Saturday. Well, you know, this is like in Acts, they believe the same thing. They all shared everything in common. Why would you share everything in common? You know, there's a story about how one guy sold all his goods and, you know, they lied about keeping some of it back. But why did people share all this stuff? Why didn't they save it for the retirement or for college or something like that? Well, it makes perfect sense. If you think Jesus is going to come this week or next month, it'd be stupid to hold on to your money. It'd be best to get rid of it. And this is what the camping followers did. They really believed the end was near, so they did all these things like, you know, one guy spent all his money and things like that. So, you know, they're really regretting it now. I'd also suggest reading critics of the Bible, like Bart Ehrman. He's also a former Christian. He's a scholar. Pastors will not tell you the difficulties they know about the Bible. The reason why is because their job as a pastor is to build your faith. After a church service, they want you to say, "Pastor, that was an amazing sermon. I just felt closer to God. That was great." They know if they say, "Oh, here's a controversy. I'm trying to figure this out myself, but you know, here's something for you guys to chew on." They're not going to say something like that. They're going to hide that from you. They're just going to say only things that they think they can build you up. So you have to go outside the church to find the other side. I know somebody who is a former Christian, and when you ask her, "Why are you a former Christian?" she goes, "Well, I never knew about this other stuff until I looked on my own." So it's like, just go out there and see what the critics are saying, because you're not going to get it in church. And I have a master's in ministry degree, and I took a preaching class, so I know something about, you know, how to preach. I mean, I did some practice sermons and things like that. Let's see. Okay, thank you. Another category, I think, is consequences. Sometimes, you know, it's a very comforting message from Christianity. You know, if you believe in Jesus, you're going to have eternal life. You're going to live forever. I mean, who wants to say, I mean, is it a good message? I mean, as an atheist, can I go out and say, "Guess what, you're going to die and that's it"? You know, it's not comforting. You really can't compete on that. But, you know, our message is, that's the truth. When you die, you go back to where you came from, nothing, you know. And it really goes against our strong breeding. We were bred with a very strong survival instinct. A lot of people, in fact, who want to commit suicide find out they can't do it because they have this survival instinct that kicks in. And for example, even if you go to a top ledge and look over, you'll notice that there's something that just kicks into you. It's like, whoa, back off. There's this thing that's really, because we've been bred that way, it's very, very strong survival instinct. So when somebody comes up to you and says, "Hey, you can live forever," you're really tagging onto that. So my bottom line, and really the most important point I want to make for the whole night, and this is something that evangelists or Christian apologists actually agree with me on this too, is that, and I think Dan Stephen in his book agrees with me on this, is that it's number one, the most important thing I would say is to seek the truth, no matter what the consequences are. For me it was very painful to accept from what I consider the truth, because I gave up what I thought was a personal relationship with Jesus. I gave up what I thought was eternal life, and I'm trying to deal with these things, and it was very difficult, especially coming from that background. But I've been having some success, but it's very painful to go through that. And you have to be willing to do that. A lot of people, you know, would rather just spend their time watching TV and stuff, and they don't want to go through that. So instead of dealing with that, it might be easier just to forget about it and just say, "Well, maybe, you know, there's eternal life, you know." So I just really encourage people, I guess, to seek truth. And then as far as accepting death, that's actually a big thing, I think, that we need to go through if we're going to accept reality. And I think there's these different stages to go through. Like the first stage is denial. You can say, like, "Hey, I'm going to heaven. You know, I'm not going to die. I'm going to live forever." Then maybe there's anger, like, "Geez, I guess maybe I might die. Why did God have to make this system like this?" or something. And then maybe there's bargaining, like, "Hey, you know what, there's these people making these breakthroughs in science, like Walt Disney supposedly, I don't know if it's true or not, supposedly had his head chopped off and frozen and then he can be brought back to life later on. Some people think that they can download their brain, their consciousness into a computer, the future technology. So these are ways of trying to bargain with it. Maybe that we can escape this death somehow. And then finally you get down to depression, like there's no way out of this. Oh boy, this is dark. And then finally you get into acceptance, like, well, okay, I guess I'm just going to, you know, how do I deal with this? And you find that you can enjoy life, you can enjoy the moments, you can enjoy your loved ones. And temporary life is actually making life more meaningful. For example, a football game that never ended would not be fun. The good thing about these games is at the end, you have a winner. So imagine if you had to live forever and you can't even end it. Even after a trillion, trillion years, it's a drop in the ocean. You still have eternity. It's like, I can't even end this if I wanted to end this. I'm tired of this. I mean, trillion, trillion, trillion years, and it's just still starting, you know? So, I mean, a lot of it doesn't make sense when you think about eternal life. So, anyway, just to recap, I think there's typical errors for evidence of God, God of the gaps, feeling, using feelings when you shouldn't, the Bible, which is really messed up.